In this tutorial, I'm gonna share with you how to invest in startups step by step. And at the end of the video, I'm actually gonna walk you through a website. I'm gonna make an investment in a startup right here, right now in this video. So this is gonna be as in-depth as possible. I'm gonna include chapters and maybe grab a pen and a piece of paper, maybe an iPad, whatever you need to take some notes. In the first part of the video, I'm gonna answer some frequently asked questions about startup investing. I'm gonna share with you exactly how to invest in startups, where to find the companies to actually invest in, how much money to invest in, how to do research on the company, how to analyze an investor pitch deck slide by slide. And I'm also gonna share some different terminology that's often tossed around in the startup investment world. Now, this video is actually part of a series where I do investing in startups and I talk about the actual investments I'm making with my own money. I share how I analyze the company, I go through their pitch deck, the bull thesis of why I'm making the investment. So if you're interested in that, be sure to subscribe to the channel. Tap on the notification bell so you don't miss out on the next video. Before we get started, a quick introduction. Hello, what's up? My name is Ferris, and I'm the co-founder and CEO of a global technology and media company. On this channel, I help entrepreneurs and investors realize their full potential. So if you're building a business or investing in businesses, make sure you subscribe to the channel, like this video, and let's begin. The first and most obvious question is, what is a startup, and what differentiates a startup from, say, investing in a publicly traded company? There's a few main reasons. Now, the first one, when you think about a startup, is the business model. Oftentimes, a publicly traded company like an Apple or a Facebook, they've already figured out how they're gonna make money, how they're going to market, and how they're scaling. A startup is still in the process of developing their business model and trying to figure out how to get to market and get to that next level. Another difference between a startup and a public company is obviously the scale. So a startup is just getting started. It might be 6 months old, 6 years old, but it's oftentimes in the first few years and it's just developing from an idea, and really it's only a few team members, the founders, maybe there's, you know, 10 or 20 individuals running this business, as compared to a more established company like General Motors or one of these massive companies that might have 10,000 employees or 100,000 employees. And the third difference, which is fundamental to the investment side of things, is what type of structure they have. So a publicly traded company is available for investment from the general public on some type of an exchange, like the New York Stock Exchange. So you can go and you can trade Tesla stock at any time during the day, heck, any time during the weekend as well. And so a private company, which is a startup, does not have that opportunity. It's sort of a closed offering. And when there is an opportunity to invest, it's normally for a limited window of time. This is a very big difference between a startup and a publicly traded company. Another difference between a startup and a publicly traded company is that a startup is often owned by either the founders or a limited number of investors and early team members. A publicly traded company, on the other hand, might have a few individuals that own significant equity stake in the company, maybe 5 or 10% of the business, but the rest of the company is owned by investors. These could be public market investors, these could be private equity funds, hedge funds, and a lot of these different funds will go in and buy parts of the company on the open market, or these investors have come into the company before the company even went public. Contrast that with a private company, and a startup might only have a few different shareholders, including the CEO, the founders, and maybe one or two early investors. The next question, if you invest in a startup, how do you actually make any money? This is a really good question. So in a publicly traded company, it's very easy to buy and sell shares of a stock. If you buy it at a lower price than what you sold it for, then you'll be able to have some kind of a profit. If you sell at a price lower than what you bought the stock at, then you're gonna have some sort of a loss. In a startup, the only way that you can make money is one of four or five different ways. The first is that the company eventually becomes public. That gives you liquidity, meaning you invest in the company at the early stage, and then 5, 10, 15 years later, the company is on the public market, and then you can sell your public share of that company, that piece of stock, to another individual, and then you can return some type of liquidity in that way. Another way that startups often return for investors is through an acquisition. This is actually much more common than an initial public offering. This is basically where the company is bought by another company. So Facebook acquired Instagram for $1 billion. And in that transaction, all the early investors in Instagram ended up benefiting because that was a cash deal. So, you know, Instagram never went public, it just became part of Facebook. Another way this can happen is through a private equity investment or full acquisition. So instead of a company buying another startup business, a private equity fund will actually buy the business, and it'll be a similar process where a larger company is just eating out a smaller company. Another way that you can make a return by investing in a startup is through dividends or revenue share. There's also the opportunity for a secondary offering. So if you were an early investor in Uber, for example, some of those investors were actually able to get their liquidity back because these investors were able to sell to other investors in a future round of funding. And in the future, we believe that there will be a secondary market different from the public market, like the New York Stock Exchange, where you can actually trade different shares of stock in privately held companies. This currently does not exist, but I wouldn't be surprised if this exists in the future. Another common question is, how long does it take to actually make a return on your investment? So you invest in 2021, when can you see a potential return? Now, oftentimes you want to have a long-term horizon on this because you might not see any return at all for years, if not a decade. So, you know, maybe you make an initial investment and then the company is acquired 1, 2, or 3 years in the future. Maybe you make that initial investment and the company goes public IPO 7 or 8 years beyond that point. Oftentimes, you should have a long-term horizon because there is no set rule here, and you need to only be investing in amount that you're willing and able to lose. So don't take this as investment advice. Always do your own due diligence. Investing has risks. This video is for entertainment purposes only, so keep that in mind, but always do your due diligence and know that you're investing on a long-time horizon. Okay, so if you're investing on a long-time horizon, then what is the best case scenario? Like, how much money could you actually make? High risk, high reward, right? Yes and no. Oftentimes, you're investing in that high-risk asset, the startup, the private company, because there is some disproportionate return. Maybe you make 10 times your money. Maybe you make 100 times your money. Maybe you can make 1,000 times your money or 10,000 times your money. If you were an early investor in any of the publicly traded companies that have above a $50 or $100 billion valuation, you will easily over 1 to 10,000 times your money. Now, those are called unicorns for a reason, because most of the time, an investment will never make it that far. Oftentimes your investments will fail. And at the end of the video, I'll share a little bit more about how you can de-risk yourself as much as possible. So if that's the best case scenario, then what's the worst case scenario? Honestly, you could lose 100% of your money. So even if you could make 10,000 time return, you could also lose all of your money. So again, investment has risks. Make sure you're smart with your investments and you only invest what you're willing and able to lose. If there's so much risk, then why would you invest in startups in the first place? There's a few different reasons why you'd want to do this. Obviously, there's to make money and make disproportionate returns because there really is no other asset class that has the potential to return more than a startup. Think about it, if you invested in Amazon back in the 90s, right? Or even in the early 2000s, you would easily multiply your money by adding a few zeros to it. Sounds awesome, right? If you're not all in it for the money, maybe you're in it for just the sake of helping the entrepreneur take their idea to life. Innovation is the driving force of the economy. And if you really believe in an idea or the problem that the entrepreneur is trying to solve and you want to support that, that's very admirable. And that's one of the reasons why I invest. So make sure you pay attention to what's out there because you might be able to take that idea and turn it into something amazing that has a huge impact on millions, if not billions of people around the world. Another way is to diversify your portfolio. So not only is it, you know, to make money and also to help the entrepreneur, but by diversifying your portfolio, you often hedge against a potential downfall in the public market. It gives you an opportunity to invest in a lot of different ways that really diversifies your portfolio. Important question, who should be investing in startups? Now, you might be thinking, well, anyone can invest, right? As little as $10 or $100 on some of the websites we're going to talk to. And I would not actually agree with that. I would say there's a few reasons why you should not invest. Number one, if you're really crippled in debt. And number two, if you have not already invested in less risky asset classes. So for example, if you haven't already invested in the public market, you should go and look up some other YouTube channels and see how do you invest in the public market. And alongside that, then you can start to invest in startup companies because you don't want to have all your eggs in one basket in terms of being in the riskiest asset class. So really make sure you do your due diligence, but also explore other asset classes. And I also recommend you should just invest in yourself. So if you don't really have much cash flow or much money lying around in the first place, you should not be trying to find the next Facebook or Amazon. Instead, you should be investing in yourself and your education, any means so that you can put yourself in a position later in life to have more cash flow, to make more money. Maybe it means starting your own business. Maybe it means getting a pay raise, getting another job, a better job that makes more money. Whatever it is, make sure that you're investing in yourself before you invest in even the public market or let alone in startups. In terms of how much money you should be investing, think about it as an alternative asset class, and oftentimes this should make up 1 to 10% of your entire portfolio. When we're talking about alternative asset classes, that means something like, you know, cryptocurrency or startups, something that has a chance to give you disproportionately good returns. At the same time, it might go completely to zero. So you shouldn't go all in. Here's an example. If you have $100,000 that you want to invest every single year, the number really doesn't matter. Think about it in terms of percents. You have $100,000. Only 10% of that, so $10,000, should go into these alternative asset classes. That doesn't mean you invest in one startup, maybe it does, but I would recommend actually that you have more diversity in your portfolio within that asset class. So if you have $10,000 to invest in startups, maybe you make 10 investments at $1,000 each, 10 different startups. And if you do that every single year, over the course of a decade, you'll have 100 different investments that you've made. There's a high likelihood that 1, 2, 3, or 5 of those will end up being massive winners that will carry the weight of the entire portfolio. So how do you find startups? If they're so awesome and you wanna make this investment, this alternative asset class, where do you find them? Number one, I would say, is just networking, being connected to other entrepreneurs so that if the entrepreneur chooses to raise money for their business, or they happen to be connected with another entrepreneur who is raising money, that's an awesome way to get started. Now, not everyone is an entrepreneur or knows entrepreneurs, so luckily with the internet, we can democratize that. But there are a lot of different websites that you can explore. I'll talk about some of those in just a few minutes. And you can check out these websites. There's hundreds of startups raising at any given moment. If you're a professional investor, some of these, and I'll define that, are exclusive for those accredited investors. Others, the general public can invest in. Also, there's a lot of different networking events that you can go to, and not in the time of Roni Rona, but in the future and in the past, there's a lot of different networking events that startups are pitching at, and they're actively trying to recruit investment. So if you are a professional investor, accredited, and you wanna go to those events, they're all over the country, all over the world, and you can meet some really exciting startups and entrepreneurs. I already mentioned it, but you might be thinking, so what is the accredited investor, professional investor? So an accredited investor is basically defined by the SEC, the Securities and Exchange Commission, as an individual that makes over $200,000 per year in income or has over $1 million in liquid net worth, excluding their primary residence. So if you own a massive house and you own it and it's over $1 million, that doesn't really count. So you need to have $1 million in cash or stocks or something liquid in addition to your primary residence. Now, the $200,000 income requirement is actually for an individual. It's $300,000 for the household. So if you have two people making 160 grand, that's 320, you would qualify as an accredited investor. And what this basically allows you is to invest in certain deals that are not available to the general public. This is in the United States, at least. So love it or hate it, that's how the system is set up. And if you are not an accredited investor, there's still so many different companies that you can invest in the United States alone. Over 560,000 new companies are started every single month. And now not all of those will raise, you know, only a couple percent of those will raise. But if you think about it, you know, that's 5 to 10,000 new companies every single month that are launching, that are trying to raise money that the general public can invest in through some of these open public offerings that we're about to do in this video. Now let's dive into the 5 different websites that I've outlined for you guys. I'll make sure they're linked in the description. The first one is called AngelList. Founded in 2010, AngelList is one of the oldest and most established equity crowdfunding platforms. It was originally conceived to broker connections between cash-strapped tech entrepreneurs and angel investors, so high-net-worth, tech-savvy founders. And there are 3 main ways that you can invest in companies and funds on the platform. There's deal-by-deal investments, which is basically registered investors can partner with investor syndicates led by notable lead investors like Jason Calacanis, or basically people with Silicon Valley experience or the like. Notable syndicates are on the platform, and they have dozens or hundreds of investors who pool their resources to make low 6-figure investments. So the average check size, anywhere from $200,000 to $350,000 per deal, but the minimum investment is only $1,000 often. So you can get into that at a lower level. There's also an AngelList Access Fund, and this basically offers access to dozens or hundreds of individual deals. They're all vetted by AngelList, and they cut out the due diligence responsibilities. Not 100%, you should do your own due diligence, obviously. The minimum investment here is $100,000, so this is not for everyday investors, obviously, if you're able to put $100,000 in one company. And then there's professional investors with AngelList, and this service is limited to high net worth individuals and institutional investors, so like family offices. They can afford to invest $500,000 all at once. So a few different opportunities on AngelList. It's definitely one of the hot ones. You'll see a lot of conversation on Twitter. I mentioned a few notable investors, so make sure you check that out. Another one is called Wefunder. This is the top equity crowdfunding regulation CF site right now. Wefunder's minimum investment threshold can be as low as $100, although a lot of offerings require at least $500 or $1,000. This is actually the website that we raised over $500,000 for my company. So the listed offerings with Wefunder are, you know, startups like biotech, green energy, insurance, logistics, retail, packaged food, breweries. You'll find everything on Wefunder. And Wefunder's comprehensive listings include detailed sales metrics and often easy to look at graphs and charts, which I really like, and summarize business plans, interviews with, you know, potential investors or actual investors who invested in the company. So Wefunder is awesome. You should definitely check it out. The next one we're going to take a look at is called Seed Invest. Now, Seed Invest is a more bottom-up platform that specializes in highly vetted investment opportunities. The platform claims to accept just 1% of applicant companies, the creme de la creme of startups. Though its company profiles are mostly invisible to the general public, if you're a registered investor on the platform, you get access to a wealth of descriptive and financial detail about each listed entity. Plus, you get direct access to founders or executives. Now, I wouldn't say direct access, but you get some access. The majority of the listed companies on Seed Invest are individual tech startups, though there are a lot of options in other sectors and a handful of multi-company funds. Seed Invest has an escrow system that allows folks to invest in companies directly through the platform. And there are some funding transactions that occur outside of the platform at the discretion of each participating company. And this is actually really common. A lot of times companies will raise part of the money on a platform, part of the money off of the platform. Seed Invest was once open only to accredited investors, known as Reg D, which we talked about, and the remaining were exclusive to accredited investors, and now it's really opened up a lot more because non-accredited investors can invest as little as $500 in tier one and tier two companies. Really, really interesting. Now, the next company that we're gonna talk about is called Republic. Republic is very similar to WeFunder. They're actually competitive platforms to each other, trying to recruit entrepreneurs to raise on these platforms. And specifically, this platform has investing opportunities with high growth potential across startups, gaming, real estate, even crypto. The platform is available for individual investors as little as $10. And also accredited investors. I remember the minimum was like 50, and then I saw some deals for $10. That's pretty crazy. There's also something called the Republic Note, which is really the first ever profit sharing token that pays out when certain startups and private equities that raise with Republic sell or go public. So they're doing a lot of interesting things. They also have a mobile app, so make sure you check out the mobile app and you can explore real estate deals on Republic as well. Now, the next one we're gonna talk about is called StartEngine. Now, StartEngine is the third largest equity crowdfunding platform in the United States. Startups on StartEngine have raised over $250 million for over 375 businesses. So a few hundred startups on each of these platforms. And StartEngine helps companies raise money, and they work with different celebrity types like Mr. Wonderful from Shark Tank. I know he's a big advocate. And you can invest in startups for a few hundred dollars. So their minimums are kind of weird. You know, it might be like $400 or $700 that you need to get started. And really, some of the differences between these, like equity crowdfunding sites, are gonna get you earlier stage companies compared to AngelList or Seed Invest. You know, those are a little bit more vetted. There's more accredited investors making moves and investing in those types of startups. But at the end of the day, they're all startups and they all have incredible entrepreneurs. There are good, bad, and ugly startups that are raising on all of them. So again, make sure you're doing your due diligence. Okay, let's go ahead and find a startup to invest in and put some money to work. So right now I'm on WeFunder. And as you can see, it says 206 technology companies have been funded. There's a lot of companies, so I already did some due diligence to keep this video concise. And we're actually gonna make an investment in a company called Adam Lim. So we're gonna go ahead and click on this and get to their profile. Adam Lim's the world's first mind-controlled bionic arm. That sounds incredible. So here's their profile. Now, a lot of these platforms, whether it's Wefunder or all the other ones, they're all gonna have a few core elements. So I'm gonna walk you through what to pay attention to on the website, not only the financials, but also just how it's structured and some things to keep an eye on to make sure you're doing your due diligence. Now, all of these companies will have some type of a video. And if you play the video, oh, there it is. What's going on, CEO? And oftentimes it'll either have like the CEO giving a talk, or it's gonna have some kind of demo and it's gonna show you the product or the service in action. And you're gonna see a lot of other videos as we scroll through on this Wefunder landing page. So after you watch the video and you think it's interesting, you're gonna see, you know, obviously the name of the company, you know, it's a little bit of headline. Now this one, it looks like it's almost sold out. I actually, you know, I've been looking to invest in this company, but I waited to make this video. I was like, oh crap, I hope they don't close this. So it looks like they've raised over $1.1 million so far from 1,586 investors, got a $100 minimum. And here you actually see the investing term. So you see the instrument, so the future equity. This is a safe, simple agreement for future equity. We'll talk about that. And it sort of explains it here. This is a valuation cap, which is not the actual valuation. It is the price that is set for when the company raises an additional round of funding, what your equity position will convert in. So if you were to have $1 million in this 10 million cap, this is gonna be 10% of the company, roughly. I'm simplifying a lot. And it looks like there's a different perk. So if you invest, you know, $5,000, you're gonna get a jacket with an embroidered logo. That's pretty cool. And then if you invest over $10,000, you get to visit their factory. So a lot of companies on these equity crowdfunding sites, at least, will have types of perks. The professional investor sites like AngelList or SeedInvest, I don't think they really have stuff like that. They might have some perks, but normally it's not material stuff. Now, if you scroll down, you're gonna see some headline bullet points here, like why you might wanna invest. Now, oftentimes these are gonna be, you know, the top, you know, traction points, or like they have a specific team member that's done something incredible. They've won an award. They have a certain amount of revenue. So here, $120 million grant from the Department of Defense. And so this company we'll talk about has been doing a lot of research and development. And so your investment, you know, here is not gonna go towards this $120 million grant. Really, this is, you know, backdoor has been invested through the institution, the university, we'll talk about it. And then this company is actually taking the technology to the market and is actually commercializing it. So, you know, the platform is gonna have, you know, a quote from other investors. This gentleman is the lead investor. He invested $25,000 in this round. He invested $25,000 in the last round. It's gonna show you some of the team members. I always like to do due diligence, so I went ahead and clicked on the LinkedIn bio of each of the different entrepreneurs, and you basically want to just check out like what were they working on before they started this company. It looks like he was the co-founder of another business. It looks like he has a lot of, you know, startup experience, education, what he studied, who's he connected with. I clicked on each of these individuals, you know, the chief design officer, CTO, CEO, because you want to get an idea of who you're actually investing in at the earliest stage. And so you basically creep their LinkedIn, maybe do a Google search. I went ahead and went to YouTube and I found this interview with the CEO, Tyler, where he's talking about the business and how it started. He actually explains how, you know, John Hopkins is involved and how they got the $100+ million grant. And then now they're commercializing this technology. So that's really, really interesting. Now, if we, oh, I'm jumping around a little bit. Let's go ahead and look some more. So you're gonna see, you know, they're in the news, they're making moves. That's really good to see a company in the news. And then you're gonna find the pitch deck. So it's really important that I actually, you know, I'll read a lot of this information on the landing page. You know, there's an investor Q&A, what does your company do? Why do you choose this idea? And then you can look at the financials, but I always like going to the pitch deck. So let's go ahead and look at the pitch deck, and we're gonna learn some things, and you're gonna see how I analyze a pitch deck. So here we go. Adam Lim's, the world's first mind-controlled bionic arm. That sounds incredible. And so the most advanced robotic arm in the world, according to these different, you know, CNN is saying this is like something from space. So the first slide of any pitch deck, normally they're less than 20 slides, it's just an overview of what they're trying to do. Oftentimes they get into the problem that the business is solving. If you don't understand the problem that the company is attacking, there's something missing there. It should be very obvious what the problem is, what the solution is. And if you can't understand that within, you know, 30 seconds, it's probably not a good investment for you, or at all, because you don't understand what they're trying to do. So it shows right here, trying to make a, you know, a timeline to show the evolution of technology and showing this is where we were in 2007, where are we gonna be over the next decade? And so what's stopping the progression? And it looks like this is really the problem slide. There's poor neural control, no finger control, no tactile feedback. And so that's really interesting. This is, yeah, I guess, you know, how do we solve those problems? Here is the solution, introducing the Atom Touch. And this is the revolutionary human scale robotics and neural control breakthrough. So I guess the idea is using your mind to control this robotic arm and fingers and the Atom Touch. And so I guess this is showing how it actually works. Watch our arm in action. It's an amazing 30-second video. Really shows the power of this technology and what is possible. And it's showing here that this is state-of-the-art robotics. The Atom Touch, sort of going into the weeds a little bit about the technology. So if you're into that, that's really cool. And it says here, invented at Johns Hopkins University, funding here, this is the $120 million grant. And so for the last 10, 15 years, here we go, 2005 grant. So for the last, you know, 10, 15 years, this group of scientists, of innovators, have been working on this technology, and now the technology is ready for commercialization, going into the market. And this is some of the traction that they've had. So anytime you're looking at a deck, you wanna see traction. Trialed by 20 amputees, tested by the, you know, the government, the military, that's really good. And here it looks like this is the secret sauce. You know, you wanna find what does the competition look like? What is the secret sauce? How is this gonna scale really, really big? We also wanna find out about the market opportunity, which we haven't really seen yet. Like, how big is the market? Is this good for like five people, or is this gonna impact 50 million people? So here it shows the neural mind control. And what this sounds like is an operating system for this mind control. So that way you can actually control the limb. And I imagine this is just the first product that can leverage this software technology. And so here is the accruing advantage. Basically, the more usage, the more improvement. So it sounds like there's this artificial intelligence, this learning algorithm that will actually be able to take the mind's inputs and develop the functionality over time to be better and better, more and more human-like. So this is really cool. I mean, deep learning at scale, like the more people, the more powerful. It's got like this flywheel. And so anytime you want to make an investment in a company that's early, it's how are they going to differentiate themselves? How are they gonna grow? What is their flywheel? And how are they gonna get to market, and how big is that market? So, here we go, right away. $2 billion market opportunity in the United States. So it talks about, you know, how many people could actually use this solution, like how many people have this problem. You wanna think about that when you're looking at a company. You know, here is the revenue. It looks like, you know, this is the revenue model. So business model, how are they gonna actually make money? It looks like it's $100,000 to $200,000 per arm, and they have a 50% margin, and they're selling to people who, you know, who need a limb basically, and it can be reimbursed by insurance. It looks like the competitors are potentially more expensive. And it looks like this is how they're gonna get to market, how they're gonna sell. US Department of Veteran Affairs makes a lot of sense. Again, if you're not in this industry, you know, this is really obvious or not obvious. And if you are in the industry, maybe you have some other ideas of how they could do this. And finally, we have the team. At a startup, it is all about the team. Who is leading this thing? And it looks like Tyler, the CEO, has previously built a startup and sold it, right? Selling is important because we talked about the only way you make a return is if the company goes public or is bought by another company. So unless you're seeing that kind of experience, or they have advisors who've been able to do that, it's not really good. So you wanna make sure that these people have that kind of experience. Here we go, this, the chief design officer, 30 plus years working at Apple, IDEO, Intel, Palm. These are like the big companies. If we know who knows how to make products, Apple and IDEO, I mean, that's the creme de la creme. Here we got some advisors on the medical side, defense. So they've got a really great team put together. And it looks like their go-to-market strategy is on this timeline. And so, you know, it's good to see, like, okay, if you raise $1 million, how are you going to spend $1 million? When are you going to raise more money? And it looks like this gives a clear indication of what they're doing. It looks like you need FDA approval. That adds a lot of risk, I will say, to an investment. And yep, here we go. Here are all the risks. So they didn't really mention that, I guess, but it is a risk. You got to drive down the cost, because if it's $300,000 an arm, who's gonna be buying that? The insurance might wanna cover a competitor. I do think the investment reason why I'm investing is because obviously this is gonna help a lot of people, but the neural, you know, adaptation, the AI, the learning, that is gonna be huge. And I think that can be applied to a lot of different things besides this arm, whether it's for amputee or other use cases. And this is the future. You wanna see the vision. Anytime you're making an investment in this, you're investing in the long run. Where is this gonna be in 10 years, in 20 years, in 30 years? Hard to think that far ahead, but you need to see visionary execution. You need to see a big vision, because like we said, high risk, high reward. You gotta make sure you're going after something big. And the future, the human body 2.0, I don't think there's any going back once we get into this. Here, final slide talks about the terms, raising up to $1 million. Looks like we already blew by that in the beginning of 2021. These are the milestones that the funding is gonna take them to, and this is all of that information. So now that we've got a good idea of the deck, I've watched this interview that's, oh my goodness, over an hour and a half. I checked out and creeped on all the different founders. Now, what we're gonna do is we're gonna look finally at the rest of this documentation on the actual, oh, this is the Form C. We're gonna look at the rest of the campaign page, and we're gonna fact check some of these things across the Form C. So the Form C, kind of like an S1 when a company goes public, or Form D on a different type of price offering. You wanna make sure that you understand that these numbers make sense. So, you know, if it shows $6,000 cash on hand, how much money they've raised previously. You wanna see like where are the numbers coming from. And so every company that raises through Regulation CF has to have a Form C. All right, now we're looking at the Form C, and we have the name of the issuer, which is the name of the company. You can fact check when they're incorporated, make sure you're not investing in some kind of a shell company. I always like to look at the ownership in the company, like who owns the company currently. And so you can look at that, like Tyler. Tyler is the CEO, head officer. You can also see his ownership. So it looks like the three co-founders split the company up 33% each. Really good to see that, you know, not one person owns like 99%. And that is not even the CEO. It's like some random angel investor from, you know, 5 years ago who owns all the company. You want to make sure everyone's well incentivized and working towards things. So we can also see like how much debt the business has. So I'll just search debt. And you can see, you know, short-term debt. You know, these are the simple agreement for future equity. You can oftentimes look at the terms. And really, if anything that you're curious about, you can probably find in the Form C. Now, oftentimes, this is like 100 pages. If you want to really go through the weeds, you can do that. I would not recommend it. Only go through it to confirm or any inquiries that you may have had to make sure that the business is legit. Okay, let's go ahead and make an investment. So I'm going to invest $500. It says, when I type it in, qualify for investing perks. If I add a zero, ta-da! Add another zero. Now we're not gonna invest $50,000. We'll keep it at $500. And I'm gonna go ahead and click on this invest right here. And we're gonna see what happens next. So I'm taken to this landing page. Now I'm going to blur out a few different things here that you see on my account just for privacy's sake. Here's the investment amount. It looks like there is a $10 fee being added. It has the deal terms. Make sure everything looks good. You don't have accidentally another zero added to your investment amount. And you also have to confirm that you have read all of the investor education material, that you understand basically what you're getting into. So you're gonna go ahead and have to check off all of these boxes. And now once you've checked off all the boxes, all you have to do is complete the investment. Now, one thing that I skipped over is that I already have an account with Wefunder. So you have to have an account with the platform that you're investing in. You can't just go in and just sprinkle money around. So you have to have an account created. You also have to link up a bank account, or I believe you can actually invest by credit card. I wouldn't recommend it because there's fees associated to that. So if you can have, you know, some type of a ACH connection with a checking account or something like that, or a savings account, that would be ideal. And I'm gonna go ahead and click on complete investment. And then I believe there's gonna be a pop-up asking me to give some feedback or share a note to the founders. Yep, here we go. You've just invested in Adam Lim's. Let the founders know why you invested. And it says, you know, type right here. They say, thank you. Don't forget to check out our amazing videos. Keep up the great work. I am very excited about the opportunity to support you guys. All right, if I can spell. And I'm gonna go ahead and send the message, and then you can share on social media. Great. Now what's gonna happen is you're actually gonna get an email. So right now I'm looking at my email. It says your application has been accepted, transferring soon. And if you look at the offering right here, my investment of $500, I invested on, these are the terms, and it shows all of the relevant information, how Wefunder, the platform, actually makes their money. So just, you know, good to confirm this. And then once the money is actually moving from the escrow into this company's bank account, you're also gonna get a notification. And anytime there is a change made to the terms, this probably won't happen because this round is pretty much over. But anytime a term has to change or something like that, you will have to recommit your investment. So let's say the terms were at a 10 million valuation cap and there's a 20% discount, but then something dramatically had to change, had to refile something. You will have to go in and reconfirm your initial investment. Voila, we made an investment online right here in the video. I'm super excited about this particular startup. If you haven't checked out some of my other videos I've done on how to invest in startups besides this video, and also my other investments that I've made in startups, and I make a video breaking down the slide deck, breaking down the opportunity and why I'm making that investment. Just understanding the psychology of how you analyze a company is super helpful. If you notice, I've made over a dozen investments, so make sure you are doing your due diligence and diversifying your portfolio. I recommend having a plan before you actually get started. So knowing exactly how much money you want to allocate of your portfolio in this specific asset class, and then also how many deals you wanna make. You know, I made a video on the biggest mistakes that angel investors make. I talk about 10 different things, and one of them is investing in the first deal that you see. So maybe you saw this company and you're really excited about it. Maybe you see another company on a different platform and you're like, this is the greatest thing since sliced bread. Maybe, maybe not, but make sure you look at enough companies so you have a better idea of what your appetite is for different types of industries, different maturity level, different types of CEOs, and make sure you know how many investments you want to make in a given period of time. That way you don't run away with the simplicity of, oh, you know what, I want to invest a lot in this company and I'm not going to invest as much in this company, because you already have a game plan set up ahead of time. If you want to keep learning, make sure you subscribe to the channel, like this video, and let me know if you have any questions in the comments. I'm going to link a ton of resources in the description and in the comments of this video to continue in your future learning, whether that's books or online courses or any other videos that are relevant to this specific topic. Finally, if you thought this video was useful, make sure you share it. I really appreciate it. And if you haven't already invested in that like button, go ahead and smash the like button. I wish you guys the very best of success in anything that you set your mind to. Have a great day and keep hustling.